Cool. So yesterday what we have studied about, yesterday about Matplotlib. So it was a data visualization library used to just show the data that you have in a graphical way. Now the same thing that we're going to study today is a data visualization library, but this time it's going to be Seaborn. And yesterday I've told you about Seaborn is that all the things that you can do in Matplotlib is available in Seaborn. And Seaborn also has some additional features which is not available in Matplotlib. So basically Seaborn is built upon Matplotlib. Just like Matplotlib is built upon C++, Seaborn is built upon Matplotlib. So all the functionalities of Matplotlib is available in Seaborn, but you have some more extra functionality. Now you may ask that if all the functionalities are available in Matplotlib, if all the functionalities are available in Seaborn, then why we even use Matplotlib? So there are only two things. First is it's your personal preferences. If you only want to use Seaborn, it's completely fine. No problem in that. There's one small thing which can tell you, like which can force you to use Matplotlib, is because Seaborn is built upon Matplotlib. So executing the same graph, like giving the same amount, same amount of data and trying to print the same type of graph, Seaborn will take a fraction of a second more compared to Matplotlib. Because in the background, Seaborn will convert its code into Matplotlib, Matplotlib will convert it into C++, and then the things will get executed. But if you'll do the same thing with Matplotlib, you're just removing one step. So Matplotlib is a bit faster. You can just say a fraction faster compared to Seaborn. You'll not feel the difference when you're plotting the graph here, but when you have a data set of like 10,000 rows or 15,000 rows, then you'll feel the difference that, okay, Matplotlib is a bit faster in printing the graph as compared to Seaborn. So we'll start the Seaborn plots. Now, first we're gonna see three of the plots, which are for continuous data. These are dist plot, joint plot, and pair plot. So we'll go each of them one by one. So how to implement the Seaborn library using import function. So import Seaborn as SNS. Again, it's an alias. You can use any word you want, but most of the time we use SNS. Now we are using a data set. SNS also has its data sets inside the library. Inside its library, SNS also has some default data set present. You can use this data set to just give an example something. So SNS has a data set known as tips. So to use any data set of SNS, you just have to use a function sns.loaddataset and provide the name of the data set. If you want to know which all data set is present in SNS, you can just go to the SNS folder, see what all data set is present there, and you can use any one of them if you want. And if you don't want, you can just again get a new data set using pandas. It's completely your choice. So for this time we are using the tips data set. The tips data set is a 244 rows and 7 columns data set. The 7 columns are the 7 features having total bill, tip, sex, smoker, day, time, and size. So it's just a data set of a restaurant, and the data tells you that what is the size, like when people came, what was the total bill that they made, what was the tip that they gave to the waiter, what was the sex, are they smoker or not, on what day they came, and what time they came. And size is the what amount of size they have, like 2 people came, 3 people came in group, or 5 people came in group, like that. So you have this data set. So first we'll see a correlation with heat map. So correlation is one of the really important thing that you'll see in machine learning. So let's talk about correlation first, because it's going to be really useful for you in the future. So just imagine you have 2 attributes, age and height. So from the range, let's just only imagine that from the range of age of 0 till age of 30. Okay, age of 0 to age of 20. You can tell when the age is increasing, the height will also increase. That's common thing, that if the age is increasing, the height will increase, unless and until some tragedy happened or some kind of shit happened, this is the normal thing that will happen. If the age increases, the height increases. So that's a correlation between two features, that changing upon early, changing the value of one feature will change the value of other feature, that is known as correlation. Now correlation is of two types, either positive or negative. Now positive tells, upon increasing one of the feature, the other feature will also increase. Now you can see this example with age and size and height only. Increasing height. So at least, okay, till after 20, your height becomes stagnant. But before 20, your height increases. So this is a positive correlation. Now just take an example of the more amount of time that you'll spend on social media, the less your marks will become. Hypothetically, it's not always true, but hypothetically, the more amount of time you spend on social media, the less your marks will go down. So it's a negative correlation, because increasing one of the feature will decrease the other feature. So that's a negative correlation. So these are the two correlations that you have. Now, even for correlation, you have a high correlation or a low correlation. And you can have like high positive correlation, low positive correlation, high negative correlation, low negative correlation. Now, what is high and low? High correlation means a small change in one of the feature will make a big change in the other feature. Like, what can I say? I'm not getting an example for this. Okay, just imagine you have a matchstick. The amount of oxygen that you're giving is the, like, that amount of time the oxygen, the flame will stay. Now adding a small amount of liquid oxygen, it's not possible to get liquid oxygen randomly, but adding a small amount of liquid oxygen, the heat will increase exponentially. So that's what a high positive correlation. So just one feature is increased a bit, the other feature will increase a lot. It means a high positive correlation. A low positive correlation means changing one of the feature really hard, means changing one of the feature very much, but the other feature which is correlated to it will change, but a little bit, not that much, just a little bit it will change. So that's a low correlation. Same happens to the negative one. If it's a high negative correlation, so for a small change in one of the feature, there will be a big change in the other feature. A low negative is a small change in one of the feature, a high change in one of the feature will show a really small change in the other feature. So this all is correlation. Now you can just imagine correlation, like you can just see the situation and imagine that, okay, this can be a high correlation, this can be a low correlation. But in machine learning, you have to give all the things as a numerical value, because computer can only understand numerical values. So correlation is now represented as a number. Now you can see, to find out what is the correlation between all the values, like you can see what is the correlation of total bill and tip, what is the correlation between tip and sex, what is the correlation between tip and smoker. You can have so many correlations. So for that we use one function which is known as CORR. So if you write df of CORR, you'll get a matrix. Now you can see you have five features, like 1, 2, 3, okay, you have seven features, sorry. You have seven features here. Now out of seven features, you can only see three features here and their correlations. Why? Because correlation is only applicable in continuous data. So you can see total bill is a continuous value, 16, 10, something, something. Tip is a continuous value and size is a continuous value. So only these features will have correlations. Any categorical value like male and female, smoker, no N, yes one, day, Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, time for fun, or in time, dinner, or breakfast, lunch, these are categorical values. So there is no correlation between categorical values. There is only correlation between continuous values. So you can see, if I'll write this, so it will give the correlation of each and every feature against each and every feature. So you can see, if you want to find out what is the correlation between total bill and tip. So if I'll go in the matrix, I'll see total bill and tip. So it's a 0.6757. So it's a positive correlation. So if the amount of, if the total bill increases, the tip also increases. Now it's 0.6. It's, you can say it's high, like it's good enough. Now total bill and size. So if the total bill is increasing, the if the size is also increasing, it means the number of, the more the number of people, the more the number of total bill. Common sense. So all the things have positive correlations. If anything has the code negative correlation, there was a negative symbol here, that minus 0.6757. That can also happen. It means you have a negative correlation. So I guess everyone understood like what is the idea of correlation. If you didn't understand 100%, it's fine. When you'll go to this one, some of the machine learning algorithms, you'll get to know what exactly a correlation. So now you can see this is a really small matrix, easy to understand. But when you'll work with large data set, you can have like 55 features. So having a matrix of 55 into 55, it's not really easy to look and understand. So what we can do, we can make a heat map. Heat map, it just represents the correlation in the sense of colors. How to do that? So we just write sns.heatmap and we provide the data df.correlation. So we can see the thing that we had here, total bill tip size is here. So instead of numbers, it's showing it in a color combinations. So you can see there's a scale. So the darker the color, the lower the correlation. The lighter the color, the higher the correlation. So you can see this is really dark correlation. So there's a really dark color. So it means the correlation of tip versus size is somewhere around 0.5. So if I'll see tip and size, it's somewhere around 0.48. So it's somewhere around 5. Now you can see total bill. Now you can see there's a correlation of 1. There's a correlation of 1 only when the exact change in one feature will make the exact change the other feature. That sometimes happens, but most of the time only happens when both the features are same. So you can see total bill versus total bill. That's why we have a correlation of 1. Because the exact change in this one will also do the exact change in this one because they are exactly the same. So you can see one correlation has been represented as this color and the whole color chart is there. So this is what a heat map is. Now we'll go for a joint plot. Now a joint plot is nothing, but if you attended the last class, I showed you about histogram and a scatter plot. Joint plot is just like combining both of them. It's like you want both of them, but you do not want to make two graphs. So I just made one graph, which is known as a joint plot. So you can like have too many features inside that. It can have a scatter plot. It can be a hexabin plot. It can be a 2D histogram also, or 2D density plot also. It can have many things. So to make a joint plot, you just have to provide sns.jointplot. To provide the x value and the y value, the x axis and the y axis. So x axis is the tip and the y axis is the total bill. So making a graph between total bill versus tip. And we're providing the data as df. So these two features are from which data type, which are from which data. So we provide the data set, which is the df data set. And kind is regression. So don't think of what is regression right now. Later in the class, we'll learn about what is regression, what is not. So regression is just like trying to fit a line out of, if you have so many points, you try to make a line which is the best fit. You can see that you can say that this is not a really good line, but this is the best fit line that the model can see. Now instead of regression, let's have hexadecimal. Let's have hex. Hex is just a hexagonal shape. Now just see this graph. What you can see, you have a high density here, and you have, let me just remove while limb from here. Maybe that's why it's not okay. Let me execute the whole code first. So you can see previously when I was executing the matplotlib libraries, it was faster, but here it's a bit fraction slower than matplotlib. So joint plot, you can see there's a high density in this area from 2 to 4 and 10 to 20 is a high density. And you can see there's a light color hexagon. And when the tip is 10 and the Bellest 50. Now this what this is saying is the light, the darker the color, it means the higher the concentration. It means most out of all the data, most of the people have a total bill between 10 to 20, and they tip the waiter from rupees 2 to 4. Okay, so this is what this graph is telling. The higher the density, darker the color, it means the higher the density, it means more amount of data is in between that place. And if you can see, there's only one or two points here. So it means there's exactly like a really small fraction of the people who are making a total bill of $50 and giving a tip of $10. They're like fraction amount of people. But most of them lies between 10 to 20 and 2 to 4. And that's the same thing that's showing into the histogram. And if you have attended the last class, I've told you about histogram. So histogram just gives you the frequency, like how much frequency of data is in between that range. So you can see the higher the bar, it means the higher the frequency of numbers are there in between that bend. So you can see for between 2 to 4, you have higher graph, but for like 10 or something, you have a really low graph. If I just zoom in, you can see there is a line, there's a bar, but it's really small because it's only one instance. So for the same, for the total bill, the histogram isn't plotted here. For the total bill, and you can see, between 10 to 20, there's a high bar histogram, but for total bill of 50, there's a really small, we'll zoom it more, there's a really small histogram here. So this is what a joint plot is. It's just a combination of two or three graphs. If you want to just have a combination of two or three graphs, but do not want to print two or three graphs, make it a joint plot. So you'll have a scatter plot, a histogram, everything in a single graph. So this is what a joint plot. Now we'll come with pair plot. Now pair plot is one of the most important thing in data science and machine learning. It's not a thing to be like to display the data on. It's like if you want to see the thing that you have got to know in correlation. Correlation gives you a number. Now what if we can see the correlation between two attributes or two features in a graph, how they change? So you for that we use a pair plot. So to make a pair plot, we just write sns.pairplot and you provide the whole data. That's it. Just provide the whole data set. You do nothing. Provide the whole data set. So it will take all the category, all the continuous values. Again, the same with correlation. Correlation only works on continuous values. So even pair plot works only on continuous values and nothing else. So you can see again, total bill, tip and size is here. Total bill, tip and size is here. So total bill versus tip or something, it's giving you the correlation. Now here it's giving you a graph. What is the graph of total bill versus, let's imagine, for what is the graph of total bill versus tip? So if we'll go there, you can see this is a graph. So this is a scatter plot for all the data points of total bill versus tip. What is the value of total bill versus size? So you can see this is the data plot of total bill versus size. Now you can see this is straight line because size has a number of 2, 3, 4. It's a limited number between how much? Let me see. 2, 3, 4, 6. So it's gonna be like 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So there are whole numbers. So that's why you have only this much graph. But in tip, it's a continuous like 6.1, 6.2, 6.3. So that's why you have a scattered graph. And if you'll see in correlation, you have, if the total bill versus total bill you're trying to get, trying to find, you get a correlation of 1. If you're trying to see the pair plot, what it is giving, when both the features are same, it just gives you a histogram. That's it. This is the histogram of total bill. This is a histogram of tip. And this is a histogram of size. Other than that, it just gives you the correlation or one feature versus another feature's scatter plot. Now, this one function of pair plot, it's not even limited in pair plot, you can use it in many of the other plots, which is HUE or HUE or whatever you want to call it. Now what HUE does is, it just splits your data depending upon a categorical value. Remember one thing, when you're plotting the data, it will take only continuous value. But when you're trying to split the data on the basis of a HUE, you have to provide a categorical value. You should not provide a continuous value. It's not like it's wrong. If you provide a continuous value, it will accept it and it will try to print the value. But it will take like 5 minutes to execute the single graph. only because what exactly Hue does is, I'll tell you. Now you want to know the exact thing, but want to distribute like, okay, I want to know what is the graph of total bill versus tip, but I want to know how many of these points are male and how many of these points are female, or how many of these points are smokers or how many of these points are non-smokers. So for that, we use the function Hue or Hue. I don't know what it is called exactly. Hue. Let's take it as Hue. So we provide the Hue as smoker. So it's going to split your data. It's just going to categorize the data between the smoker category. So you can see smoker, blue stands for yes, and let me just execute it again so that it can boom. So smoker here. So blue stands for yes and orange stands for no. So now you can see you have the same data. You have the same graph, total bill versus tip. So total bill versus tip, we have the same graph, but now you have a differences between which one is smoker and which one is not. So orange stands for no smokers, and blue stands for all yes smokers, like they are smokers. So if you want to get a more in depth, like which are smokers, which are not, you can use a Hue. You can use also sex also. If I'll provide sex. So now you can see sex is divided into male and female. So out of all the total bill versus tip, these many people are females, these many people are male. And that's what you can see. So this is what Hue does. Now I guess you understood about pair plot and joint plot. Now we'll go for distribution plot. Distribution plot is exactly a histogram, nothing else. That's what it is. So you give the total bill or any of the attribute here. It's just going to give you the distribution of the data, like how the data has been distributed and between what kind of bins data has been distributed. Now there are like different parameters that you can provide. So what if you want to know what to come or what parameters that you can provide, you just have to go towards the end of the function, press shift tab. You will see a whole documentation, what all you can provide, bins, histogram, KD, RUG, fit, blah, blah, blah. If you want to exactly know what the work, go towards the go a bit down. It will show exactly what exactly they do, what exactly they do. So for a distribution plot, it just shows you the class distribution. As if I'll just remove the vertical true because it's really hard to see. Now, what I've told you is in the graph that most of the people, if you'll see the total bill, most of the people have the total bill between 10 to 20 because of the high density color here. So this is the same thing there in the distribution plot is telling, that most of the people are in the range of 20 to 10 to 20 of the total bill. There's really less people in between 50 who made the total bill of 50, but a really high number of people who made a bill between 10 to 20. So that's what distribution plot is, to give you the distributions. Now, if you want to see the distribution of tip, you can see the distribution of tip. So what I've told you in this one, that most of the people have a tip between $2 to $4. So you can see the same thing. Most of the people have a distribution of 2 to 4. Now, what was vertical is equal to true? So if I'll place it here, what is this? So vertical true. So if you're providing vertical true, it means your graph will just get vertically aligned. So if I'll execute it, you have the same graph, but it's now vertically aligned. Depends on what exact kind of resolution are you using, what kind of screen are you using, or why exactly you want to show a vertical graph. So, but there is an option of verticality also. So this is what a distribution plot is. So I guess it's enough for today, because yesterday I took like 1 hour and I don't want to drag more. So till now, what we have studied about? We have studied about plots, which are joint plot, heat map, pair plot, distribution plot. And we learned one more thing, which is correlation. Correlation is not related in Seaborn. It's a general concept, a general statistics concept, which is really useful in data science, machine learning, all the stuff, to get to know the correlation between two attributes. Because just imagine you are training a model on any feature and you get to know that there is zero correlation. It means varying that feature is not going to affect your model. Just imagine you're trying to find out what is the age of a person? You have like, okay, just leave the age. You're trying to find out that if the person is suffering from a fever or not. So you have so many attributes here for the person, like what's his age, what's his height, if this has a previous medical condition, if he visited the doctor in like 10 days or not. You have so many features. There's one feature which is what is his address. So you can imagine address has nothing to do with either that person is suffering from fever or not. There's no relation between the person's address and his health condition. So you can see there's zero correlation. So if you find out, like you go to the correlation graph, and you found out that there is one correlation, there's one attribute or one feature which has a zero correlation. It means you can just easily drop that column. You're not going to use it in any machine learning model, because if you're going to use any feature which has zero correlation, two things will happen. First, it will take you more time. Leave it. It will take you more time to train your model because you have one extra feature, and your model performance will degrade because the model will try to find a correlation between the person's address and its health condition, which is not present, but the model will try to find out. This will indirectly will hamper your performance. So if we have a zero correlation attribute, just happily remove it. This is what correlation is. So just remember correlation. If you don't understand exactly, it's fine. Just have a gist of idea so that in future when we'll work with machine learning models, you'll remember what is correlation when you'll work on it. So this is for this class. If you have any doubt, you can just turn on your microphone and ask, or just type in the text. I'll be watching the chat here. And if you have no doubts, then you can just say okay or a thumbs up or anything, it's fine. No doubts. Nice. You understood all the things? Gajav? Okay. Okay, a genuine question. You have no doubts because you really understood everything, or you haven't even heard a single line what I said? Be honest. What is the exact thing? You haven't listened to anything, or you literally understood everything? Gotcha. Nice, bro. Nice, Anisha. Nice. Okay. So next class. Okay. So I'll share this. Let me see what. Okay. Everyone understood, I guess. Okay. Nice. So I'll share this notebook. You can see the distribution plot here, and you can see it in this distribution plot. Now there's one more category, which is categorical plot, which we'll talk about tomorrow. So if you'll see the categorical plot, you can just try to play with it. Maybe you'll understand a bit more by just by playing with it. And before even me explaining you, you may understand all the things, because it's really simple. It's not, should we practice Seaborn on Kaggle? You can practice Seaborn on your own laptop only. It's not like you'd need a really high GPU or a really high CPU for Seaborn. The data visualization exercises, you can do that. You can just go and try to find out any proper computation of data visualization and try to do that. Okay. One more thing I want to ask. Should I give you some assignments, or it's fine? Answer, answer, answer. You want assignments or like some kind of project? So it's fine. You want to be like free with assignments and all. Really? Okay. Really? If the teacher asked me that you want assignments, I wouldn't have thought a single second before saying no. Okay, project is fine. Assignments, I always say no. Guys, if your teacher is asking if you want assignments, say no. If a chemistry teacher is, okay, fine. I hated maths. So if math teacher also asked me, I would have said no. I actually hate assignments only, so I don't want to. I don't even write my assignments. I just make my juniors write my assignments. In return, I treat them. That's it. Cool. People can relate. Haven't read my. You haven't. No. Completed my assignment, so you're not gonna get anything. So, what I'm thinking is, tomorrow after explaining seaborn, I'll just give you one small project which you can just say that it's a data visualization project. I'll give you a data set and I'll tell you what exactly you can do. Can you take sessions on Kaggle and how to crack competitions? Bro, chill down. Kaggle competitions are not really easy. You need to have so much amount of information about what all models you have to use. And even before models, the one of the biggest thing that you have to know in Kaggle to like crack something in Kaggle, like to find that top three position, which even I never reached, is the data handling, the exploratory data analysis thing. That how to handle the missing data, how many features are there which you can handle the missing data. Even I have no, like I haven't know all the what all the algorithms of what can I say handling the missing data. They're like a lot and people are coming up with new ideas, so it's really hard. So for now we're not jumping on Kaggle or any of the machine learning competitions. Currently what we are thinking or what you're planning is to make sure that your base is ready. After that you can just go in Kaggle, you can just go in hackathons or anything you want. By the way, it's really good that you are thinking of going on Kaggle. I never thought of that. So, what I was saying is, I'll just give you a data set. It's gonna be a good data set. So, on the basis of the data set, I'll tell you to plot two graphs. And before plotting the two graphs, I'll tell you to do some data, like exploratory data analysis kind of thing, so that you'll have a revision of NumPy and Pandas. Okay. All of you have studied about NumPy and Pandas, no? I guess you all did. Yes or no? Cool. So before in the graph, you just have to do some stuff about some stuff in the data set to make it more like, usable, so that you'll have a practice of data set and practice of NumPy and Pandas also. And after that, you just have to print two graphs on the basis of the data set that you have given and the data set that I have provided, and submit it. No marks. No deadline. It's upon you. You want to do it. It's good. You don't have time to do it. It's completely fine and understand. People are busy with other stuff also. So it's just a practice for you. If you want to do, you can do. If you don't want to do, it's fine. If after the question, like I've provided a question, if you have any doubts in that particular data set, or if you are like you want any help, you can text me in the group or text me personally. It's better to text in the group so that everyone will get to know what kind of error they can go into. I don't know, like I tell this thing to each and every batch I taught, but I don't know what they never understood. They all the time they text me personally, and there's no problem in texting me personally. But the thing is, you're running into an error, the other person is not. So you ran into an error, you came across that, you overcome that error, but you learned something that this is the error and this is the reason because of this I found this error. The other person who didn't ran into that error has no idea about it. So in future, if he'll run into that error, he'll face some difficulties. So it's better that if you find any error, like any random error that you get in doing something, post it into the group so that everyone will get to know that, okay, this is an error that you will come across. And when someone will post the solution, so everyone will get to know that, okay, this is an error. To overcome this error, this is the solution. So that more people will get to know about more errors. And I guess all of you know, the more errors you get, the more learning you'll get. So that's it. That's today's class. I guess, okay, today's class is limited in 40 minutes. As I told you, it's not going to exceed 40 minutes from now. So I'll post this Jupyter notebook there. Any doubts? The group is always open. Okay then, bye-bye. Let me stop the sharing and pause the recording.